فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، first of all, I wanted to apologize for coming late, specifically for these classes, because we only have 2 hours. The reason is not because I woke up late or anything. It's just that this book doesn't have no sharah. Kitab Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslima doesn't have a sharah. I haven't seen anyone who has explained it. So what it needs from me is every single point to look for. I have to make my own explanation for it. So it takes time. So since Fajr, when I prayed, until now I was just going through it. And then I saw it a bit late that the time had actually passed when the class is meant to start. That's why I came running late. But the kitab doesn't have no sharah, it has no explanation. So I have to go to the tafaseer and aqwal of the ulama and tahleelat al-masail and here. Because it's different when you read a book by yourself. It's different when you read a book by yourself, than when you're explaining it to people and explaining the information that are in it. We spoke about, in the previous lesson, the conditions that Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani mentioned that are a condition for the jilbab al-mar'at al-muslima. The hijab that a woman needs to wear, the conditions that it needs. And the Sheikh mentioned 8 conditions. And we were on the first condition, which was isti'abu jami'i al-badani illa mastuthni, that the outer garment worn in public must cover all of the body except the face and the hands, according to Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah. And then the Sheikh rahimahullah, he brought Surah An-Nur, ayah 31, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهْرَ مِنْهَا إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْآيَةِ. And we were on the explanation of this verse, and the exegesis of this verse. We mentioned what it means, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ, tell the believing women, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to lower their gaze. يَغْضُضْنَا. We said the word يَغْضُضْنَا is a fi'il which is majzoom. And it is majzoomun لِجَوَابِ الطَّلَبِ, which is mahduf, which is أُغْضُضْنَا, and then a meaning which comes فَيَغْضُضْنَا. Then they will lower their gaze. Command them, lower your gaze, and then they will lower their gaze. مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ, their gaze. وَيَحْفَظْنَا, and safeguard, and protect their private parts. And what we said was, Abu Aliya rahimahullah, he gave a qa'idah, a principle. Abu Aliya, he said, kullu ayah, every verse, nazalat, which it has come down in the Qur'an, where you are told to protect your private part. Every ayah of the Qur'an, which protecting the private part is mentioned, means protecting them from zina. Except from this verse, he said, according to him, Abu Aliya. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَا, and not to show off their adornment. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَا, that they do not show off their adornment, except that which is apparent. The Mufassirin, the people, scholars of Tafsir, they differed what is meant by illa ma zahara minha, except that which becomes apparent. That which is apparent. What is meant by that? There are 2 views regarding what is meant by that which becomes apparent. That which is apparent. So the woman should cover and she should not show off her adornment. But then Allah does an exception. What does Allah do? He does an exception. The exception which he makes is this, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except that which becomes apparent. So the woman has to fully cover her beauty, her adornment, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except that which is apparent. So the scholars, they say, what is meant by what is that which is apparent? Inshallah, Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah is going to bring the two views, but just so we have an idea, the first view is the view pushed by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Hassan al-Basri as well, and also Muhammad ibn Sirin and Abu al-Jawza and Ibrahim al-Nakhai. So this view is pushed by the first view, which I'm going to mention inshallah ta'ala, is a view pushed by Ibn Mas'ud, Hassan al-Basri, Muhammad ibn Sirin, Abu al-Jawza, and Ibrahim al-Nakhai. And this opinion is what is meant by illa ma zahara minha, that which becomes apparent, is the outer garment. In other words, when the woman, she puts her hijab on and she covers fully up, she still may sometimes, things might become apparent from her. Things might be seen from her. In other words, the hijab might stick to her, or مثلا, her body part might show after pricking up something or doing something unintentionally. This is what's meant by إلا ما ظهر منها. In other words, when the woman wears a hijab, she shouldn't wear another hijab on that one, oh, and then another one on that one, then it will be an infinite, it will be an infinite action, where she would always have to cover the hijab, because that hijab is shown, and she would go on. So Ibn Mas'ud said, what is meant by إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا is after she puts the hijab on, and she fully covers up, whatever then shows is not upon her. This qawl is Ibn Mas'ud, we're going to see it soon inshallah. Al-Allama Al-Hafidh Ibn Kathir is going to bring that qawl inshallah. And this view is attributed to who? It's attributed to, alaykum as-salam, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Hassan al-Basri, Muhammad ibn Sirin, Abu al-Jawza'i, Ibrahim al-Akhari. The second view of ulama, second view of the scholars, is a view attributed to Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas. And what does this view suggest? Abdullah ibn Abbas is the one who said this view. Before I mentioned what the view mentions, this view is attributed to who? Abdullah ibn Abbas. It's also attributed to Abdullah ibn Umar. It's also attributed to Ata ibn Abi Rabah. It's also attributed to Ikrimah, Mawla ibn Abbas. It's also attributed to Sa'id ibn Jubayr. It's also attributed to Abi Sha'tha. It's also attributed to Dahaq ibn Mazahim. And this is the Qawl ibn Jarir al-Tabari al-Baghawi chose. So this view is attributed to the following A'imma: Ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, Ata ibn Abi Rabah, Ikrimah, Mawla ibn Abbas, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Abi Sha'tha, Dahaq ibn Muzahim. And this is the ikhtiyar and the choice picked by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari and Al-Imam al-Baghawi. And this statement of Al-Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, also Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah is going to bring it in the kitab Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslima. And we're going to read it inshallah ta'ala in its lengthy wording. So we have those two views. The first view we said is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and those. The second view is by those a'imma. But what is the second view? The second view is إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except that which shows, is referring to الْوَجْ وَالْكَفَيْنِ, is referring to the face and the two hands. In other words, she should fully cover up except her face and her hands. Except the face and the hands, and that's what the ayah is talking about. So the exception here, that she shouldn't have to cover, that she shouldn't have to place the hijab over, is what? إلا ما ظهر منها, this exception is the face and the two hands. This قول is by the second party of scholars in which I have stated and I've mentioned. And we also mentioned last lesson that Hafidh ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he said regarding this verse, هذا أمر من الله تعالى that this is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believing women. لِلْنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَغَيْرَةٌ مِّنْهُ لِأَزْوَاجِهِنَّ, and jealousy on his part over the wives of his believing servants. عِبَادِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَتَمْيِيزٌ لَهُنَّ عَنْ صِفَةِ نِسَاءِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ وَفِعَالَاتِ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ. It is also to distinguish the believing women from the women of the jahiliyyah and the deeds of the pagan women. He says, هذا أمر من الله تعالى لنساء المؤمنات وغيرة منهن لأزواجهن عباده المؤمنين وتمييز لهن عن صفة نساء الجاهلية وفعالات المشركات. He says that this is a command from Allah to the believing women, and jealousy on his part over the wives of his believing servants. It is also to distinguish the believing women from the women of the jahiliyyah and the deeds of the pagan women. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the verse, he says, وَلْيَضْرِبْ, before we move on to وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ, these two views represent the two views pertaining to whether the face and the hands are awrah, and whether a woman should cover it, and whether she should not. Because it's this ayah that those who say it's wajib use, and those who say it's not obligatory for a woman to cover her face and her hands, this is the verse which they use. This is the verse in which they use. And one of the strongest arguments that is pushed by those who say that the face and the hands of a woman is an awrah and she should cover it, is before Allah says, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا. What did He say? What did Allah say before He said, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا? He said, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ, that they should not, the believing women, that they should not show off their adornment. So the ones who said that the face and the hands are awra, they said that the greatest form of adornment of a woman is what? Her face. If Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala not to show off your adornment, the exception cannot take out the greatest form of adornment. Sheikh Nasir said, هذا فلسفة, that's philosophy. That you come with, we come with evidences. Sheikh Nasir said, this is a philosophy on your side. We're not coming with philosophy, we're coming with adilla, qala Allah, qala Rasul. And you'll see his kalam inshaAllah ta'ala. We're going to transmit it from his kitab, Ar-Radd al-Mufham. The point of the matter is, both parties are pushing this issue. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ, that they, the women who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are mu'minat, they should not show off their adornment except that which is apparent. Then Allah says, وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُنُوبِهِنَّ, and then Allah says, and they should draw their veils all over their juyub, and not to reveal their adornment. Allah says here, and to draw their veils. وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ. The khimar is the thing that the woman has on her head. The little khimar that she puts on her head. This part of the verse is saying, and let them throw and draw their khimar over what? Their juyub. Juyub is the plural of the word jayb. And the jayb means that which comes from the neck. All of this circle here is called juyub. Are you with me? Somalis, they call jayb pocket. You guys call it pocket? This is not the Arabic language. The word jayb is what comes out from the neck, the part that's open for the neck to come out. So the woman, she should throw and she should draw the khimar which is on her head, ala juyubihinna. So what will it cover? It will cover her neck and her blossoms, her chest. Nowadays, what do we see? Women who are wearing hijab only this much. Her neck, her chest, her stomach, everything can be seen. Is this what the ayah is saying? No. The ayah is saying, وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا. They should take the khimar that's on their head. And she should what? She should cover her neck with it. Her neck is not allowed to be seen. عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. So she fully has to cover her neck. And she's not allowed to show it. Abu Dawood narrated in his Sunan. Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, he narrated his Sunan. I want you to all ponder on this. And look at the situation of the believing women at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Aisha said, إِنَّ لِنِسَاءِ قُرَيْشٍ فَضْلًا. The women of Quraysh have virtue. The women of Quraysh, they have virtue. Meaning there's no, we can't dismiss the virtue of the people of Quraysh. But she went on to say, وَإِنِّي وَاللَّهِ, but I swear by Allah, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَفْضَلَ مِنْ نِسَاءِ الْأَنْصَارِ. But I never saw anyone more virtuous than the women of Ansar. The women of Quraysh are of virtue. They are of high integrity and nobility. But she said, I never saw the likes of the women of Ansar. أَشَدَّ تَصْدِيقًا بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. How they believed and how they took on the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا إِيمَانَ بِالتَّنْزِيلِ. And I never saw anyone more severe and greater in the women of Ansar in what? In believing the revelation that is sent on them. I've never seen anyone like this, the women of Ansar. تَصْدِيقًا بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ, the way they believe in the book of Allah. And the way that they are true and faithful to the revelation that is sent down. لَقَدْ أُنزِلَتْ, it was sent down, سُورَةُ النُّورِ وَلْيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. سُورَةُ النُّورِ came down. And this ayah where Allah says, and drew their veils all over their juyub, and not to reveal their adornment, except to those who Allah permitted for them to show it to. When it came down, وَلْيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ, she said, إِنْقَلَبَ رِجَالُهُنَّ إِلَيْهِنَّ. Their men, the verse came down, their men turned on their heels, meaning they went backwards, to go home and to inform their women of the verse that came down. Now look at the women who, some of them are feminists, and some of them have that tendency in them. They say, how dare a man tells me to wear hijab? And how dare a man informs me of the matters pertaining to covering up? When the ayah, وَلْيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ came down, the men who took this ayah from the Prophet's mouth, they went back home. The way they came, they went back home. يَتْلُونَ عَلَيْهِنَّ, they were reciting these verses. بَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِمْ فِيهَا, they were reciting these verses on these women, informing them that this is what you need to do. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. This is what Allah needs from you subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how the Sahaba men were. That they would make sure that they educate the women with the concept of hijab. Then you look at the women on the other side. The women, the muhajireen and the ansar. How were their response? Were they saying, how dare you come and tell us these rulings? It's not your job. Why are you interfering in the affairs of women? It's none of your business. Leave us alone. It's between us and Allah. Allah knows what's in my heart. Allah knows what's in my heart. No, they didn't. The women of Ansar, what did they do? When their men read it on them, and their men didn't just tell their wives, عَلَى مْرَأَتِي وَابْنَتِهِ وَعَلَى كُلِّ ذِي قَرَابَتِهِ. They went and they told their wives, and they told their daughters, and they told the women around them, their mothers, their aunties, their maternal and their paternal aunties, they informed of all of the women around them about this ruling and what has come down. No one said to them, you guys are overzealous. You guys are excited. Rather, what did they do? فَمَا مِنْهُنَّ امْرَأَةٌ There was not a woman from amongst those women who were informed. إِلَّا قَامَتْ Except she stood up. She didn't say, I'm going to buy the hijab tomorrow. She didn't say, I'm going to look for one next week. I'm going to have to go to the shop and check if there's the right one is there. قَامَتْ She stood up. إِلَى مِرْطِهَا She stood up to her cloths that she had. الْمُرَحَّلِ That were decorated. And what did she do? She ripped it into pieces. And فَعْتَجَرَتْ And she wrapped herself around that one. She made it in a way that it fully covers her up. Why Aisha said, بِتَصْدِيقًا وَإِيمَانًا This was in belief and in surrender. بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ That which Allah said down subhanahu wa ta'ala مِنْ كِتَابِهِ فَأَصْبَحْنَا This came down in the night and in the morning. فَأَصْبَحْنَا وَرَاءَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ Aisha said, we women, at the morning fajr, we became مُعْتَجِرَاتٍ كَانَ كَأَنَّ عَلَى رُؤُوسِنَا الْغِرْبَانِ We were behind the Prophet praying like there was on our heads crows. The way we tied everything over ourselves and we covered ourselves. Some of the riwayat and some of the narrations mention when the ayah وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ came down. When the ayah came down وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ Aisha said when it came down the women they took their waist sheets, their izar and tore them at the edges from the sides. And they covered it with their faces. So this shows وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا which is a fi'l amr. You're being commanded. What are you being told? What are you being told? The woman is being told to what? To draw the veil over herself. What did the women understand that has to be? The face. So they took this command as the face has to be covered. This shows you that covering the face of the woman is wajib. Based on the understanding of the women of the Prophet's time, alayhi salatu wasalam. And there are a lot of fiqh that you can take from this one hadith that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha mentioned. That these women, their virtue and their honor and their dignity, how high it was. And their nobility, how high it was. They didn't hear of a command of Allah except they surrendered. And when our women are like that, when our women are like that, and our men are like that in the things that are obligatory on them, we will then receive the breeze of victory again. And we will receive honor once again. When the people are what? In line with the Sharia. In line with what Allah commanded subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will then restore back to us what? Al-Majd wal-Izzah. Honor and victory that we've lost, that we seem to not have, will all be brought back to us. That's why the Prophet said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ شَيْئَيْنِ I have left two things with you. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا As long as you're holding on to these two things, لَن تَضِلُّوا You will never be misguided. The misguidance is with a person who left one of these two. What is the first? The Book of Allah. Look how Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, how the women were holding on to the Book of Allah. And the second is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How they were holding on to it. And how they were regarding it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا Let them draw their khimar. وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ Let them draw their khimar. And we said the khimar is what? On the woman's head. عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ Over their juyub. And the juyub, we said, it's what comes out of the... Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives an exception of... Who is it that the woman is allowed to show herself to? These groups of people Allah tells us that the woman can show her adornment, her beauty to, are the following. The first one is, إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ and do not reveal their adornment except to their husbands. The woman is allowed to show her beauty to who? To her husband. And he's allowed to see it. And the man is allowed to see his woman fully naked. Shara'an is permissible for him. She can do that only for her husband and no one else. She can't do that for her father, nor her brother, nor her sister. She's not allowed to do it. She's allowed to fully be seen by her husband. And the opposite is the truth with the man. As for the women, she's allowed to show them what she would show her maharim. The scholars, they differ what a woman can show another woman. The view that we mentioned is she wears what she normally wears at home. Like when she takes, her neck can be seen by another woman, her hands can be seen by another woman, her face can be seen by another woman, her hair can be seen by another woman, and her feet can be seen by another woman. Anything other than that, she should avoid showing it to any other woman. Especially if this woman is known to go out and about and talk about women to her husband, then a woman should fully dress up from her. And she should not show her anything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, لا تباشر المرأة المرأة. No woman should describe another woman. فتنعتها لزوجها كأنه ينظر إليها. No woman should describe another woman to her husband so that it is as if he's looking at her. She describes a woman to her husband and how she looks. And this is something that is what? The aslan, that woman that's being described to you is a woman that's covered from you. The man that's asking his wife about another woman and the way she looks is a fasiq. And the woman that's involving herself in this conversation and giving it to her husband what this other sister looks at and the way she is and describing it is also aiding her husband in munkarat, in evil. This is sins that she's accumulating. And many situations you find that later some zina or haram may occur from what? From this person you've described to your friend, your husband, sorry. And you've told him about this woman and the way she looks. And the minimum that can happen is that he goes and marries this woman and it causes you headache. It causes you headache that he goes and he marries her. This is if he does halal. So even then you can prevent that. Huh? You can prevent that by not talking to him about how this woman looks and her description and her physical appearance. This is something you don't do and you don't speak about. It's haram from you, shara'an, to speak about it. But if you know there's a sister who does that, and she goes about and she talks about other women's way they look and the way they dress, then you as a woman should cover up from her. And you should not allow her to see your beauty. She should not see your beauty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, the husband or the father. The father is allowed to see his daughter's face and her hands, her neck, her hair. These points I'm going to mention, take her on board and it's very serious. Sisters, pay attention to this point and wallahi, it's very important. The Sharia came to prevent problems. It came to prevent problems. It is wrong for a woman to dress at home with her brother and her father in the house in a very, very promiscuous way. Her chest is showing. She's wearing a mini skirt. Or she's wearing something as tight that can, and it's see-through. And we have seen, وَلِلْأَسَفِ الشَّدِيدِ, brother and a sister doing haram with each other. Or you find a father doing something haram with his daughter. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Why is this bad thing occurring? Because the matters are not being taken serious. The issue is not being taken serious. The matter is not. Walidhalika, you see a sister jumping up on her brother, throwing herself at her brother, touching places of her brother that she shouldn't. And these are waqa'i' reality. If there wasn't, I wouldn't have spoken about something that doesn't exist. And one thing leads to another, and then you come to a conclusion or you come to a final matter where you're unable to get out of the problem that is there. The Sharia, what has it come to do, ya ikhwa? Al-wiqaya khayru min al-ilaj. Prevention is better than cure. The Sharia has come to stop these things from happening. That's why when the children are young, the brother and the sister, what did the Sharia tell us to do? وَفَرِّقُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ. Distinguish them from one another. The brother, the boys, they have their own room, and the girls, they have their room. They're already being taught. This is it. This is the boys' room. This is the girls' room. Sisters are not entering into their brother's room, sleeping on his bed with him, and hugging him, and kissing him on the lips, and هَذِهِ مَا يَجُوزُ. It is not permissible. And are these things that happen? You see brothers and sisters who the way they are to each other, لا ينبغي, it's not right. لا شرعاً is it permissible, and even عرفاً is not permissible. Or a father whose relationship with his daughter is like that. These things, when they don't get taken serious, they lead to مفاسد, ما الله به عليم. They lead to corruption, big problems. And I'm sure many of you know situation that happens, sahih? Where father's doing something wrong with his daughter, or the daughter and the brother and the sister are doing something wrong with each other. Why? Because the illness that's in the heart and the mind of this boy, in whatever circumstances that this happens, this is your sister at the end of the day. And a father, this is your daughter, this is your damuka wa lahmuk, it's your blood and your flesh. How would your mind and heart give you to do this? It's illness that's on the side of this individual. But also the woman has to take precautions. She needs to protect herself. She needs to protect herself. And know the seriousness of this and the filthiness that we are around nowadays. I'm going to, even though I have a lot of information, I'm going to cut the class very, very short. The reason is because I'll take more questions from you all. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, Shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.